is 2026 the year of the robo-taxi?
I would say 2026 is the year of the Zoox robo-taxi.
I think it's going to be in 2026 where this really starts to take off.
If I just zoom out, today in 2026, most of the autonomous activity in the world is happening in China and in a handful of cities in the US.
You're here.
It's the buzziest topic in Silicon Valley, and the public is going crazy for it.
It's a new experience, I'm looking forward to it.
But enthusiasm alone isn't enough to get us to a robotaxi world. 6 years ago, Elon Musk confidently predicted he'd have 1 million self-driving Teslas on the road by 2020. One of many predictions that proved to be too optimistic. After hearing that robotaxis are here for several years in a row, we're told 2026 will be the year of the robotaxi. The number of vehicles on the road is set to more than double, to 18,000 this year, from 8,000 in 2025. For our purposes, a robotaxi means on-demand, point-to-point autonomous ride-hailing. It's dynamic and not fixed route.
We will continue to see a growth in autonomous taxis in 2026. It will not be a dramatic change.
Mark Fagan is a lecturer at Harvard University's Kennedy School. He also runs an autonomous vehicle lab.
This is not going to be a year in which we see 20 cities with 25 to 50% of ride-hail rides being in robo-taxis. It's all coming, but I don't believe it is a hockey stick.
For a nascent industry and business without much of a track record, there are already many players. Waymo, owned by Google parent Alphabet, takes existing cars and retrofits them with its self-driving system. It also works with car makers on purpose-built robotaxis like its vehicle with Zeekr, even though it still has a steering wheel. Right now, Waymo is the only company running fully driverless paid robotaxi services in the US without a safety driver. And it does plan to make 2026 the year that it publicly launches across America, from San Diego to Washington, D.C. Tesla and Amazon-owned Zoox are also piloting their first driverless programs, while May Mobility and AV Ride have launched in cities with safety drivers at the wheel. And in some cases, there isn't even a wheel.
The Zoox vehicle is bi-directional. It has inward-facing seats and no driver controls, no steering wheel,
correct,
no pedals. And that has been the plan from day one.
Our robotaxi has been on the road for about a year plus. We've learned a lot. We've been transporting ourselves and members of the public. We've been practicing the service, getting feedback, making adjustments. We've expanded our geofence a couple of times.
Aisha Evans is the CEO of Zoox. It designs and builds its own robotaxi from scratch, runs its own app, and wants to control everything end to end. Zoox plans to own, operate, maintain, and manage its entire fleet itself.
Why not do what others are doing and start by retrofitting consumer vehicles?
We kind of look at what happens at scale, right? And then you work backward from there. And we felt that in a way, even though at the beginning it would be slower and more difficult, at scale it's going to be easier and more ubiquitous and more consistent. And we are giving them the personalization, we're giving them the experience. And we felt that starting that way made more sense. And yeah, it's been more difficult. It's been slower, but we're seeing now with regular people using it that it was worth it. And we believe it will allow us to scale faster.
How much is this going to cost to scale the Zoox platform and offering to the visions you've just outlined, but also to sort of bring a return on everything that's already gone into this project?
It's going to cost a lot, no question about it. This is a capital intensive endeavor, but I think the returns are going to surprise people.
Then there's Tesla. Its vision is a robo-taxi service made up of three things: a purpose-built cyber cab now entering production, used Teslas the company takes back and controls, and privately owned cars. In that last case, owners would let their Tesla go out and work as a robotaxi for the day, essentially renting out their car, like Airbnb on wheels. A lot of companies are investing a lot of money on making the dream of robotaxis become a reality in the near future. But for that to happen, at some point, it has to be a business, and that means distributing the substantial capital costs across a lot of units. Sarfraz Maredia leads Uber's autonomous mobility team.
When you talk about the unit economics of autonomous vehicles, it's actually quite simple because you can start with the reality that everybody is losing money. If we were to price those rides, or any of our competitors were to price those rides sort of to break even, they really would not be competitive with, you know, any other ride you would take on Uber. And what we expect is over time that cost will come down, not just for the vehicle, but for the compute. And so as that cost becomes more competitive, I think you'll see the unit economics improve, but that's going to take several years.
It's very capital intensive, and the capital comes in two forms. One is the development of the technology itself, the software code. Think about this. You and I have spent decades of learning how to drive. So we know when it's a rainy, miserable day in New York, you're gonna be more cautious. All of that has to be coded into the software that's operating the vehicle. The other side of the capital investment is the more traditional kinds of capital you think about. You're gonna need to get relatively high utilization of the vehicles in order to pay off that capital cost.
In other businesses, the leader of the pack is the one who makes the numbers work. Robotaxis can be different. Competitors work together to harness the parts of the operation they do well to try and get to scale.
I think it is a dating situation where, you know, we're all kind of interested in each other because, look, think of the data that we have, right? We know about pickup and drop-off locations. We know how to get through into a gated community, for example.
David Risher is Lyft's CEO.
We know when people take rides every single day, you know, in every single jurisdiction in the United States. On the other hand, the robotaxi companies know a lot about how to drive cars with no human driver. We don't know anything about that. So it's actually one of those really nice things where at this time, we're all trying to sort of date and learn from each other and figure out what the models are going to be going forward.
While robotaxi pioneers in the US hunt for scale and for partners, China's racing ahead, with Goldman Sachs projecting a fleet of 1.9 million robotaxis in operation there by 2035, accounting for 25% of all ride-hailing vehicles in the country.
If I just zoom out, today most of the autonomous activity in the world is happening in China and in a handful of cities in the US. In 2026, I think you're going to see that change because you'll see more cities in the US and you'll see what is nascent operations in the Middle East. A market like Abu Dhabi, where we, with one of our partners, offered the first driverless, fully driverless ride outside of the US and China in the last couple of weeks. There, they've been very supportive of bringing autonomous tech to their city and more broadly in the UAE.
Not all robotaxi companies are operating in the same way. Where Zoox wants to build its own ecosystem, rideshare companies like Uber and Lyft want to focus on what they do best, dispatching cars and managing fleets. In December, Uber entered a partnership with AV Ride, allowing riders to order a robotaxi through the Uber app.
Main cameras are located right around the LiDAR.
Sergey Kilarov is AV Ride's chief commercial officer.
We intentionally decided to not create like their own ride-hailing app and partner with existing players, and Uber is a perfect partner for that. I think riders will benefit from having Uber's hybrid model by combining the autonomous rides and human drivers on the service.
Robotaxis may finally be on the way, but when they get here, we shouldn't assume that they'll do away with human drivers, at least not entirely.
Every day, 3 million plus people open up their phones and choose to take a Lyft. Sometimes today they're in a human driving car 99.99% of the time, but over time, increasingly, that'll be in a machine driven car. And that's great, right? On the other hand, when you want help with your luggage, or maybe you want someone to chat with at the end of the day, or maybe it's your grandmother and you want to make sure that someone actually walks her to the door at the end of the ride, that's when you're going to choose a human driver. So I think the two of them are going to complement each other really well.
Annoying glitches are one thing, but there have been much more serious problems with some robotaxis as they've gone into operation.
In 2023, there was a very unfortunate incident in San Francisco where a woman was hit by a conventional vehicle, was knocked under a cruise autonomous vehicle. The irony of this is we probably lost 100 people in the United States to car-related fatalities. We don't like when technology kills people.
We need to demonstrate with our partners a superhuman safety record that's not just miles driven, but also that the rides are going to be safe in different use cases, that they're going to be able to address edge cases.
So maybe, truly, these robotaxis are about to arrive in a city near you. They're high-tech, they're all the rage, but it turns out...
The animal that means about its mind situation.
Even if you take away a driver, you can't take away user error.
Hi, this is Aisha. I'm in a ride. Are we departing soon? What's the holdup? He's not buckled up. He is buckled up.
Maybe it can detect.
No,
that
I know
not.
That. Yeah, it can detect. Okay, thank you. I appreciate it. Yeah, no, I get it. Thank you. All right. Yeah.
We try to game the system.
This thing is okay. Aha. Off we go.
It's amazing.